And then we have more recently have started an experimental activity on cosines and functional support cases. Gabriele Ferrari, who is the lead of the group, and Giacomo Lambrosi. These people already obtained interesting results on solid tones and produced for keyboard sugar mechanism crossing in a fast way the base transition by lower and temperature in the case of solid metals. So I would like to start my presentation showing two figures that directly or indirectly have been already either shown or commented by the previous speakers. This video is the first experimental, one of the first experimental proofs of Bosanic condensation, where you can see that at by lowering temperature, we have the formation of a short peak, which corresponds to the duration of a single particle state, and it's just associated with the phenomenon of Bosanic condensation. Starting from this experiment, it was possible very soon, and here we are referring to the beginning of this new kind of condensed physics, 95 and 96, it was possible to measure the fraction of atoms occupying the single particle state, which gives the order parameter of the Bose-Einstein condensate, and to plot this fraction as a function of temperature. And what seemed very interesting was that even the number of atoms at the beginning, this was one of the first experiments, 1996, was very small. When there are a few, 2,000 or 3,000 atoms, nevertheless, it's possible to reveal in a clear way the typical feature of the phase transition occurring at some critical temperature, which, by the way, can be very well predicted by theory, because at such temperatures you can neglect the fraction to calculate the critical temperature, and then you can use the real gas model, which can be handled analytically in a very simple way. So this experiment has revealed a very important part, that the single particle state it can be occupied in a macroscopic way. Macroscopic means that the finite fraction of the total number of atoms occupy a single particle state. The year after, another very important experiment was carried out by Kepler at MIT. And this is the image that was published by the way on the cover of Nature. And this is the evidence of the interference fringes produced by two expanding and overlapping atomic states. This was shown in the previous lecture explicitly, and is an important manifestation of coherence. And so this experiment directly show that we have a macroscopic occupation of single particle states. This experiment showed that all the atoms have the same phase and they can interfere in a very efficient way to give rise to fringes as revealed by this nice picture. These two mechanisms, macroscopic occupation, the Bose-Einstein condensation, coherence, are key features underlying the phenomenon of supercritical I will talk about today. But let us go back again to the first years of activities on those applications. But when these papers were published, many people were attracted by this new achievements, and there was at the beginning a very big enthusiasm. Today it is still a big enthusiasm to start this phenomenon, and many hundreds and hundreds of people around the world Now, I'm working on this thing on light. What is the reason why this experiment attracted so much attention of the scientific community? At the beginning, at least, two important features were the reasons of the beginning. First point, was Einstein condensation, because of their money trapping, shows up not only momentum space, but also in coordinate space. So by taking pictures and images of this atomic cloud, you can see and you can realize the phenomenon of Bose-Einstein condensation. Keep in mind that before this experiment, Bose-Einstein condensation was associated mainly with the physics of superfluid helium, which is a liquid that is in the form, and you cannot take images. So you can't take, but you don't give any information. And what you have to do now, if you want to see something related to Bose-Einstein condensation, you have to measure the momentum distribution. Measuring the momentum distribution is much more difficult than taking the images in the coordinate space. And so, and this was one of the big improvements given by this type of physics, thanks to the realization of ultra-good atoms in the presence of harmonic traps. So sometimes people say that harmonic traps are not very interesting because on the point of view of condensed matter physics, one should work with uniform light systems. This is partially true, but it's not completely true, because the fact of having no uniform system gives us to an enormous possibility of investigation of dynamic properties and equilibrium properties, both from the experimental and from the theoretical. So the system is very rich also because of this. The second reason why this system became very strong and popular is that you have a good theory to describe at least the zero temperature properties both of static and dynamic neutron. And this is the cross-Michelinsky theory, which is based on the equation from the order parameter that was shown just in the previous lecture, and that I will show it again. And starting from this theory, it's possible to predict practically all the measurable things that you can know in this instance. And in general, the agreement was excellent, and so providing a general and complete understanding of the physical phenomena associated with the Bose-Einstein condensation. Now, of course, many new knobs have become available, and the physics has become more complex, richer, and of course more interesting. I would like to mention two new possibilities for systematically employed in experiments and also in theoretical applications. The possibility of tuning the spectral length between atoms by simply applying an external magnetic field. And so by changing the size of the magnetic field and talking on the fact that you have a bound state in the two body probe, which can reach the threshold of the field. And in this way, you can give rise to enormous changes in the various spectrum length. You can change dramatically also the many-body properties of the system. And so the possibility of tuning the performance is a unique and a wonderful possibility that was already pointed out. It is practically impossible in other systems. One of the most important achievements that have been realized by tuning the spectrum length is the possibility of realizing the superfluidity in Fermi gases and explore the crossover between the, what is called the VCS and the VEC regime and exploring the wealth of physical situation of the high. Now this is one possibility, but then there are other important possibilities to have with this new techniques. There is the possibility of tuning the external I started saying that the possibility of having a one perhaps was a great advantage from the point of view of imaging and understanding the properties of the system. But the harmonic tracking is the simplest tracking situation that we can have. Now it's possible to modulate the tracking conditions at which. And you can, for example, realize optical lattices, this was already mentioned, and then investigated the superfluid insulator transition. You can produce configurations with the low dimensions, 1D and 2D, and you can add a disorder, you can generate a lot of interesting physical situations. Now, this first experiment on Bose-Einstein's condensation raised also some important questions that were partially answered at the beginning and that now can be applied to more complex configurations and systems. In particular, an important question, which is still the object of investigation on the experimental theoretical level, is what is the relationship between Bose-Einstein condensation and superfluid. This point was debated from the very beginning of the discovery of superfluid fields. And in particular, after the work by Chapitza and Messner on the superfluidity, the discovery of superfluidity in England at the end of the 30s, London, a famous physicist, gave a first interpretation of superfluidity, invoking the phenomenon of Bose-Einstein condensations. This was at the end of the 30s. And before the London work, nobody knew about the very possible Bose induction. That we have written almost 20 years before. It was with the discovery of superfluidity in Hilo that the physics of Bose-Einstein condensation became attractive from the point of view of theoretical investigation. After the Second World War, the theoretical work on superfluidity in helium became very, very active. And there were many papers to understand the connection between superfluidity and Bose-Einstein condensation. But none of these papers were composite. The main reason is that in helium, Bose-Einstein condensation is not so evident because the system is strongly interacting. It's a liquid, it's not a gas. And that people realized that very soon in the 60s and in the 70s that in order to understand better the connection between Bose-Einstein condensation and superfluidity, the ideal system gases, atomic gases. And they started trying to produce atomic gases at very low temperature. And then and Florian, this morning, explained all the difficulties that we had to overcome in order to cool down atomic gas and to realize Bose-Einstein condensations. I'd like to summarize some of the difficulties. One of the difficulties is that the ground state of the gas is not of an atomic system, of a mini atom to find some single particle states in gases, but not gases, but are crystals. And so you have to keep the atoms far from each other. And you have to work with very dilute conditions, which means with very, very low temperatures, which makes the physics of Bose-Einstein condensations at very, very low temperature physics, much, much lower than the one that you have with helium. Now, liquid helium is no longer, let's say, the most attractive system to investigate, but one should always remind that liquid helium is the only permanent liquid met veel potential. En consequently remains a link from this point of view. But my own guess is that we investigate them and our own net stable contributions. So they are very interesting, but I should not forget that they are net stable systems. So the question that we raised concerning the relationship between what's happening to the citizenship of the community can be summarized then in this group of questions. Can the condensate spectrum be identified with a superfluid density? Second question, can we measure the superfluid density in an ultrafluid atomic acid? And this question now received an answer because the time of course yes, now we know that. And that's what is contained if you like in the gravity space, because we have an excellent theory for describing the behavior of of the very weak influences. And this ratio is given, as you have already shown, is given by the Gauss-Pettiers equation, which is a non-linear Schrödinger equation. So I would like to stress again what was stressed in the previous lecture, that this equation is non-linear, but this does not violate the inherently of quantum mechanics. We know that in quantum mechanics, the Schrödinger equation should be linear, while Gauss-Pettiers is non-linear. And I remember that Lerner always says that at the beginning, he wrote this equation, so many theorists said that you are the only person in the world who use a non-linear Schrödinger equation. And they say this thing with a criticism, because they said this is wrong, because we cannot use a non-linear Schrödinger equation. Now, the answer to this apparent paradox is very important and should be understood very clearly, but the Gauss-Pettiers equation is not an equation for the many-border function, but it's an equation for the order semantics. And these two concepts are very, very different, but sometimes they don't control them. And only the equation for the order number is non-linear. And the non-linearity is accounted for by the interaction term, which is fixed by the scaling rate. The Gauss-Pettiers equation predicts a lot of superfluid phenomena. Quantized vortices, irrotational hydrodynamics, pressure moment of inertia, Joseph oscillations, and many other things. In this system, because of the dilutedness condition, which requires that at the end the quantum depletion is negligible, you can identify at the low temperature the condensate density, which is the modulus square of the order temperature, with the superfluid density, which comes in one macroscopic and phenomenological approaches down, and it shows later some of these equations. And so for a Bose-Einstein condensation, the modulus square of the order parameter and the superfluid density coincide with the zero. But the relation between Bose-Einstein condensation and superfluidity is much less trivial if you now explore other situations where a Gauss-Pettiers theory cannot be applied. And in particular, this includes strongly interacting systems where phenomena associated with quantum depletion are very important. Liquid helium is an example, but we have also with gases we can produce systems like Fermi gases near threshold resonance. Ground is you have stronger correlations, and the definition of superfluidity is much less trivial than for diode atomic gas. But even more if you go to lower dimensions, for example, two dimensions, we know that we have a superfluidity. I will show some examples later. We have the so-called Jelizinski-Kostelev-Tauris transition. So we have a very special geen officiële superprojecten, maar twee grote plannen voor samenwerking. En dit kan worden proven rigorously using Bernie Wagner theorem, which rules out the existence of Bosanian condensation at 5 in total motions. Concerning the possibility of measuring the supercooled density, I would like to mention, I will discuss a recent experiment where the supercooled density has been measured in a threatening case, so that now it's possible to explore situations where Bosanian condensation, supercooled density are different concepts, and you can go measurement and you can try to understand theoretically what are the main questions around the superfluidity. In ultra-cold atomic gases show up in very different conditions. As I said, there is no unique way to define superfluidity. This is a list of physical phenomena which have been the object of systematic investigations in ultra-cold atomic gases, well from experimental proofs of superfluidity. So I am not listing here all the phenomena that can be associated with superfluidity. Many of them are so far of theoretical interest, and they have not been checked experimentally. I have a list of here, and I will show some of the main features concerning the only entities that have been measured. Well, we have experimental proofs. At the end of my lecture tomorrow, I will show also additional predictions that are interesting from my point of view, but they have not yet been measured experimentally. Let me summarize this list. On my purposes, I will talk very soon. Are very important phenomena. Professor De Cari has shown in the previous lecture the structure of vortices and also the structure of vortex rings with this beautiful novice. But what's important to stress here is the quantum nature of vortices. What do we mean by quantum vortex? Because vortices can be produced also in classical physics for fluids. An interesting phenomenon of associated quantum vortices is the possibility for a supercooled to carry angular momentum. By the way, it's the only way how a supercooled can rotate. Because otherwise, the system, due to the irrotationality associated with the motion of the superfluid, cannot keep transporting the flow. And this, by the way, shows up with the reduction of the moment of inertia, which I will discuss later on very soon. And then we have other phenomena associated with superfluid, like Joule oscillation, this was already mentioned before. The absence of viscosity and Landau critical velocity. By the way, the absence of viscosity in superfluid helium is the key, the first manifestation of superfluidity. Because the superfluid helium, we have in mind a flow which can flow without any friction, without any dissipation. In the case of atomic gases, measuring this phenomena is less trivial than measuring the other phenomena. But all these phenomena are associated with that superfluidity. Then, as I mentioned, we can have interesting phenomena in two dimensions, where we have a superfluidity without the transmutation. And this is the Brzezinski Kostec-Stowers equation, where there have been many interesting experiments in the last 2 years, in particular in the group of Jean Balibar at the Cordon Superior in Paris. Then there are some other things. For example, one of the interesting features of the critical transition supercomputing is the so-called lambda transition and lambda behavior in the specific heats. Now it's possible to mention the thermodynamic properties, in particular the specific heat, also in colder time gases, and that we can reveal the transition to the superfluid regime by studying these thermodynamic properties. And then this last but not least is the possibility of exploring the new dynamic properties. This is the superfluid. We have the propagation of second sound. Second sound is a temperature wave, a momentum wave, which can propagate because of superfluid. And this was by the way measured in historical work in the loop, but now it has been measured also for interacting cases. So quantized vortices. As I said, the possibility, the impossibility of rotating like a classical fluid originates in the superfluid from the fact that the velocity field should be the rotation. The velocity field in the superfluid is always given, is always proportional to the gradient of the phase of the overflow. And for this reason, it's there. And also the only way how superfluid carries under momentum is here, there is some quantization problem of the rotational flow, which form the structure of the vortex line. By the way, it's interesting from historical point of view to mention that the existence of vortices was the initial motivation of the whole paper that had in 1861, where he gave a prediction for the shape of vortex lines in a direct process. Vortices have been measured in the first important experiment by Eric Rommel and Gila, but then very soon in a more systematic way by the group of Jean Delacroix. The way how to produce vortices is just given by introducing rotating field, rotating, which is added to the trapping potential, and which gives kind of spinning of the fluid, like with a spoon when you mix a cup of losses. And depending on the angular velocity with which you did this experiment, you can produce one vortex, then if you increase the angular velocity, you produce two, three, four, and you see how beautiful this segment is. You can produce many vortices, and now, in the next video, you will see that you can produce even 100 vortex lines, which they form a very regular form in the presence of harmonic pressure. It's important from the experimental point of view to point out that the size of this vortex form is very small. It's less than 1 micron. And there is no way to observe it in situ because the resolution of the imaging techniques is not sufficiently strong. But what you can do, you can expand the gases, and so the size of the vortex core increases and can be imaged. And this image is taken after expansion of the gas. Okay, this is our nice images of vortex lattices produced by GLA and FMT. Well, you have 100 vortices which form a very regular lattice. This lattice is called a Brinkmann lattice because it has the same structure, the same form, the same geometry as the lattice of vortices exhibited by superconductors. Well, the effect of vortical structure is produced by an external magnetic field, while here is produced by the electric field. But there is a stronger and energy between the phenomena associated with rotation and the magnetic phenomena that are the superconductivity. What's interesting that the distance between vortices is very, very, very long, and you see that does not depend on the position when you have these vortices. Keep in mind that here, for example, density is zero, and here is maximum, because this gases are trapped with the ionic potential. So why is the distance between vortices independent of the density of the gas? The reason is that the simple arguments based on the quantum vortex lines, shows that the distance between vortices is fixed by the angle of the angle. And of course by the Planck constant and the mass of particles. And so it doesn't depend on the variables. And this has been proven in this case for bosons, and also in the case of fermions, where the group of spectroscopy was able to measure contrast vortices also in fermion cases. I emphasize the word quantum, but who tells us that these vortices are contrast? And what do we mean by quantization for the vortex? And this is an important point that is related to all our experiments that we have carried out concerning the quantization of angular momentum. So what you can prove that if you have a vortex, a quantum vortex, in a symmetric configuration, the angular momentum carried by the configuration is quantized in units of the platform. And but the point is, how can you measure the angular momentum? It's not easy, because if you take images, you don't measure the angular momentum. So a very useful way to measure angular momentum is to investigate the precession phenomena associated with the presence of angular momentum. And the mechanism for this is very, very similar to the mechanism given last to the Foucault pendulum. You know that the Foucault pendulum, you have a precession, and this precession is due to the fact that we are working in the frame, now this is not the reaction, and there is another momentum underlying our program, which is given by the rotation of the Earth. With the same mechanism, takes place in the progress. In the case of the plate for pendulum, the two frequencies which have different values, which are no longer degenerate, are the scintillation, the dipole oscillation like this, and the dipole oscillation like this. So at the end, if you get a combination of the two, see the two frequencies have different values because of the Earth's rotation, you have the precession. In the case of atomic gases, the precession of the relevant precession concerns the quadrupole oscillations, which can carry the opposite angular momentum, and you can calculate the splitting in the frequency of the two quadrupole oscillations and relate the splitting to the angular momentum contained in the system. This is an extrapolation that can be obtained using some of the techniques and holds for interacting systems. And then by measuring the splitting of the two frequencies, which means by measuring the precession mechanism that you have during the excitation of a quadrupole oscillation, like in the Foucault pendulum, you can measure the angular momentum and you can observe the quantization rule of this system. So the important message here is that these are quantized vortices. And you have quantization of angular momentum associated with this correct motion associated with the vortex. There is another related mechanism which is associated with the quenching of the moment of inertia. What do I mean by quenching of the moment of inertia? We know that a tracing system rotates in rigid ways, like a rigid body, and the consequently, the amount of inertia of the body is given by the rigid body. But in a superfluid, this is not so. Because the superfluid component cannot rotate in a rigid way. And if, in particular, you rotate at very low frequencies, so that you cannot produce waves, the system cannot rotate at all. And the question now is to see what it's possible to call this experiment. And again, one of the problems is to measure under the this connection we proposed many years ago, another possible way to explore the behavior of hydrogen. So this, you can measure the density distribution, but you cannot measure under the but if the trapping potential, external trapping potential, is not isotropic, then angular momentum and the quantum point deformations are the counter quantities. In particular, if you take the connotation between the Hamiltonian and the angular momentum, if the trap is not isotropic, you obtain this exotic. The two-body interaction commutes with the angular momentum because it's rotational internal, but not external traction. As a consequence, by measuring the behavior of the quantum oscillation, you can measure the behavior of the angular momentum. And if you like using another language, you can investigate the transverse response, which gives information on the superfluid field, you can measure by measuring the longitudinal response, which corresponds to measuring the density response. The first example here is provided by the Sisson model. What is the Sisson model? You have a trap which is deformed, and at equilibrium, the gas follows the shape of the trap. At some point, what you can do, you can, and this is easy experimentally, Florian can confirm this, so you can rotate suddenly the trap, and then the gas is no longer in equilibrium. And what the gas will do, will try to reach the equilibrium condition, but at the beginning it will oscillate. This oscillation, just like this, is an oscillation about push frequency depends in a crucial way on the velocity amount of inertia. So if the amount of inertia is rigid, classical, or if it is irrotational, superfluid, then the behavior of the convective oscillation will be dramatically different. And this was actually predicted, and then this was the full line of the prediction, and then experimentally this behavior was confirmed, therefore, in both cases by a group of Oxford and Fisfoot. And then more recently, the same phenomena have been measured in superfluid frame cases by the Innsbruck team. Let's move on to Johnson oscillation. This were already, already mentioned by you in the previous talk. I would like to start with the Florence experiment that was already mentioned. This is the trapping configuration, which is a superposition of an harmonic plus an optical periodic rotation. At some point, you shift the harmonic trap. The system is no longer in the minimum energy configuration because the harmonic trap has been shifted. And in the absence of the optical potential, the system will start oscillating, giving rise to the center of mass oscillation of a trap of a single trap. But if you have an optical potential, which creates a real between different regions, it's not obvious that the atoms too late. Because if the barrier is too high, they cannot overcome the barrier. Unless they are superposed, and the mechanism for crossing this barrier out in a coherent way is associated with the so-called Joseph-Fong oscillation. This is shown in this beautiful images, you know. You see that the red part is the condensate. The green part is the thermal part. Here they are working at high temperature. You see that if you move suddenly the amount of turbulence, only the condensate is able to oscillate, so to cross in a gradient way, to tunnel in a gradient way over the variance. But the thermal part cannot, because it cannot cross in a gradient way the variance generated by the optical potential. The same effect was investigated more directly, systematically, by Markus Rogenthal in Heidelberg. And in this experiment, he was able to produce a double well potential, a typical situation where you have two atomic clouds, one on the left, one on the right, and changing the balance of population between the two balance, you can produce the oscillation of atoms going from one side to the other, and vice versa. And this oscillation is what we call a Josephson oscillation. And then you can explore, for example, here you see the platons at the beginning are here, and then they move here. The red part is the one containing more atoms, and then back and forth, and you have the Josephson oscillation. And so now this physics is very prospective because with a double well you can produce a really interesting entanglement phenomenon in that environment. I must say that from a theoretical point of view and also experimental point of view, there are many open issues with this Joseph solution. Because you can have tunneling also in a semi-classical regime, not because of quantum tunneling. And so the real interpretation of these experiments in terms of quantum Joseph effects are still object of debate, and there are many experimental and theoretical activities in the collection.
Excuse me. What is changed from Josephson oscillation to self-tracking in the experiment?
Okay.
What is changed?
Yes, you pointed out an important. So the real Josephson oscillation is wrong.
What is changed?
The Josephson oscillation exists only if the imbalance in number of electrons is small. On the right hand side, you have a different situation, which in some sense is even more interesting and less implicated. Because here you have produced a much bigger imbalance in the occupation numbers of the two ones. In particular, you know, most of the electrons are on the left. And so one would expect that these electrons go to the right. Why this is not true? Because in fact, according to Joseph solutions, when the imbalance is too large, you have the so-called self-trapping mechanism, which can be understood by writing the energy of the harmonic oscillator oscillations. When you have the harmonic oscillator, you can have an oscillation like this. But if the amplitude of oscillation is too big, the system does not oscillate, and the angle rotates in a uniform way. So the phase rotate, but the number of atoms does not.
Number of atoms should be small, no linearly small, no?
Yeah. Yes. And so this is a very important phenomenon, and by the way, personally I feel that this mechanism is the real interesting proof of the Joseph-Fong like behavior in this system. Okay, let me go now to discuss what people in condensed matter think when they think about superfluidity, the absence of viscosity. What do we mean absence of viscosity? We mean that, for example, an impurity can move in the liquid, in the fluid, without giving rise to fiction and to terrible disputes. Why this phenomenon is predicted in Mesopotamia? This is related to the mechanism that was introduced first by Landau, which is called the critical, Landau critical velocity. The basic mechanism is given if you have a moving then if you write an Newtonian in the moving frame, then the Newtonian will be minus V times T, where V is the velocity of the entropy. If you write in this frame the energy of elementary excitations, you find that the energy of elementary excitation contains also a term due to the effect of working in this frame. And if this velocity is too large, in particular it's larger than this critical value, then in this frame you can have a dissipation of energy via the creation of elementary excitations of the system. The most typical example of the formal stability. For example, if you take the formal dispersion here, epsilon is C times A, and so this value corresponds to the sum velocity. So if you are moving with the velocity larger than the sum velocity, then you certainly will dissipate energies. Of course, this mechanism of breaking the superfluidity with the excitation forms is only one possible mechanism. You can produce dissipation with the excitation of further elementary excitation. For example, in helium, certainly excitation of protons is unfavorable, and even more the excitation of outer strings. And so this situation is very rich and complicated. But the main point is that you have a fixed velocity. If the impurity moves with the velocity smaller than this fixed velocity, then the impurity can move without dissipating energy, and the system remains superfluid. While if the velocity is more than this critical value, then the system can give rise to elementary excitations, and the superfluidity breaks down. They have heating and the mechanism of energy dissipation. This measurement of the critical velocity in principle requires a uniform system. And so for this reason, this mechanism of superfluidity is not so easily implemented in trapped cases. On this point of view, vortices, which are created by rotating a system, are more naturally produced. But here we are speaking of impurities and dissipation created by a Galilean motion of impurities, which is not easy to implement. Experimentally, this was done by Kettle and Gauss-Gates at the beginning. What's interesting is that more recently, he made a very refined experiment in a trapped frame case, interacting with the effect of resonance. I will see if you want to count and in any case, this is a Fermi guess, fully trapped Fermi guess. This is what matters now. And by adding in the center of the trap an optical lattice created by two interfering laser fields, with the tuning of the two frequencies, which give rise to a motion of the peaks of this optical lattice, you can produce artificially an impurity moving in the system. Just a second. And then by changing the velocity of produced by this optical lattice, You cannot measure the response of the system. And this is the response of the system, measured by the Jetson experiment. If the velocity of the vertex is more than some critical value, which turns out to be 5-6 millimeters per second, then nothing happened in the prism. You know, people have measured the condensate fraction of chaos, and so the system is underperformed by this perturbation. If the velocity of the optical lattice is larger, then we have a sudden production of the excitations and then a pattern of superability.
Just a small question. This is a two component variation.
Yes.
The BCS is the So below unitarity, you have that of critical velocity. Below unitarity, you have?
Below, what do you mean below?
Below unitarity, when the interaction is weaker.
Yeah, the interaction weaker, not
this is
negative or positive scattering. Weaker with the positive or negative sign for the scattering length.
Yes, scattering length is negative.
For next, you are in the BCS band. Okay, so place now.
Then you have lambda critical velocity.
It's an advanced case. The question is how you, what is the nature of elemental sequences? If you are on the BC side,
yes, yes.
Then the breaking of superfluidity is caused by the excitation of forms. While if you are on the DCS side, the break of excitation is due to the pure breaking. And then there are different mechanisms for the elemental sequences.
But there is some critical velocity.
Of course. And then the critical velocity, I have not shown the figure here, okay. Is maximum at the unitarity, where the system is most concentrated. Then the critical velocity becomes smaller and smaller when you go in the direction of the BCS size, because the gap becomes smaller and smaller. And also when you go to the DC regime, critical velocity becomes more and smaller because the form velocity becomes smaller. So the critical velocity, the main message here is that you can see from this figure the emergence of a certain breakout of superfluidity, and that the critical velocity is the largest critical velocity that you can have in this ultra-cold condensate. Because the system is very strong interacting. Still a guess, but the strongest interaction that we can have associated with the large value of the scattering. The measurement of adaptive velocity has attracted recently the attention of people working with two-dimensional physics. And I would like to show this very beautiful measurement carried out by the group of Jean-Delibon in Paris, working in two dimensions. So, as I said, in two dimensions, we can have superfluidity, but we cannot have Bose-Einstein condensation. But how can you prove that you have superfluidity? So what is the, how experimentally you can obtain this? The idea is to measure the critical velocity. If the system, if you can move any purity in the system without producing the dissipation, it means that the system is superfluid. And that this should be the case if the system is superfluid. But as soon as the system is not superfluid, immediately, as soon as you try to move an impurity, which in this case is a measure which rotates, keeping the symmetry, the circular symmetry of the system in the plane, the two-dimensional plane, then if because in this rotation the system immediately loses superfluidity, it means that the system is not superfluid. So it's very sensitive. And this is exactly what was observed, because by changing the position of the impurity just in the center, in the center the density is highest because the Gardner won't touch. And so you expect to clear the superfluidity in the center, and a normal component in the periphery. So if you are far from the center, which corresponds to this region, you see the critical velocity is practically zero or very small. Then suddenly, when you reach the point where you expect from a theoretical point of view, where the supercloud, you have a sudden jump in the layer of the critical velocity. And what's interesting here, that this supercritical velocity becomes finite immediately after entering the supercloud regime. This means that the supercloud density has a jump at the transition, and this is a typical feature of the Berezinski cosmic forms. I have not time and I didn't want to spend much time to explain these things. Maybe at the end I will show or then tomorrow about some further transparencies. But this is just to show that this experiment reveals the transition between normal and superfluid phase in two dimensions can be investigated experimentally, and that's the typical feature predicted by Costa's powers, which correspond to a sudden jump in the superfluid density as soon as you enter the critical, the superfluid phase. We know that in three dimensions, sorry, when you enter the superfluid phase, the superfluid density is small, and then becomes larger and larger as you cool down the system. Here in 2D, you have a sudden jump, and the superfluid density becomes very large immediately as you enter the superfluid regime.
In his experiments, they had, if everybody had an issue about the size of the defect that they were creating, no? So in the sense that the critical velocity that they were obtaining was like one third of the velocity that they were expecting. Was in these experiments, or because of the size of the...
One thing about this experiment is very, very difficult to compare what is measured with the experiment. Because the ideal Landau criterion does not apply in the simple relativity system. And in fact, one of the ways to measure the superfluid density here... Is what is the best way to measure the superfluid density? The measuring of critical velocity in principle is a good way, but in practice it's not as good as for the reason that you probably are mentioning. So the defects are never ideal defects. You cannot study the linear phenomena when the criteria applies always to linear phenomena. In order to measure the superfluid density in a good way, one should go to a different type of experiments, and I will discuss in the second part of my lectures, in particular tomorrow, and this is related to the measurement of the second sound. I will introduce now, I have still 10 minutes, something like this, but I have. Okay, let's go now to the last part that I would like to discuss here. It's the connection with the thermodynamic behavior of a strong interacting kinetics. And let me introduce the BEC, BCS control. At the level of two-body physics, the key point is the behavior of the scattering length as a function of an external magnetic field. We know that if you have a flashback resonance, by changing the magnetic field, you can change the rate of the scattering length between the two electrons. And the reason is that the bound state is created by the interaction between the electrons is very sensitive to an external magnetic field and can enter the continuum or leave the continuum very easily by changing the magnetic field. When the two bound states enter or reach the continuum, then the rate of scattering length becomes infinite, which does not mean that something infinite is happening also. Just a clever change in the bound nature of the states caused by the two body fractions. At the mini body level, the consequences of this behavior of the scattering length are dramatic. And these are very, very important in the physical phenomena associated. In particular, if the scattering length is more than positive, it means that the bound state is close to the threshold of continuum, but it's still finite. And in this case, the two electrons, the spin-up electrons, can form a molecule. And this molecule, if the density is very small, can give rise to a direct gas of molecules. And for this direct gas of molecules, we can apply the theory of Bose-Einstein condensation, and we have a regime of what is called the DC regime. In the opposite regime, where the scattering length is more than negative, you have the so-called DCS regime, of course, investigated systematically by in superconductivity to explain the error of electrons, some electrons. And the pairs are called the covalence. These two types of pairs are very different in it. Because the pairs that form these molecules are, as you see in the figure, well isolated relative to the rest of the system. So the size of pairs is much smaller than the average interparticle distance. So you have really a gas of molecules. And since these molecules are pairs of fragments, they are bosons. And consequently, they can give rise to Bose-Einstein condensation. And vice versa, if you go in this regime, this Cooper pairing is a really mini body effect. And this Cooper pair exists only because you have a mini body system generating a training status. And so from this point of view, they are more interesting. But what's interesting here is that you can tune in a continuum way the magnetic field and consequently the scattering length for this resonance regime. When you have this resonance regime, the field of the scattering length is very large, can be infinite in principle. And this is called the unitary limit because in these conditions, the dimensional quantities that you can build in your system are particularly simple, and you can formulate some dynamics and the non-mean body physics in a very elegant form. I will summarize some of the main issues here. So the unitary Fermi gas is the definition. It's a Fermi gas composed of two spin states. Well, the relative scattering length for the relative motion is infinite. Or if you like, 1 over a is equal to 0, which shows that something that is easier to define. We talk of infinite things and all these things that complicate simple things. Why this regime is very interesting and challenging? And now, here I have a list of properties. This system, by the way, it's direct. The interparticle distance is much lower than the range of interactions. We always need to have an interaction which are the order of atomic distances, atomic dimensions, or virtual dimensions of the order of angstroms, But the interparticle distance can be much larger. So the details of the microscopic force are not important. At the same time, the system is strongly breaking because the scattering length can be much larger than the interparticle distance. And so the system is dynamic but strongly breaking at the same time. Then the system has some properties of universality, in the sense that you cannot have explicit dependence on any interaction or anything, because the value of scattering length is important. So either everything is destroyed and becomes invisible, or if you have something finite, this finite properties of the system cannot depend on the they can't be, you have no length to describe it the interaction of the system. It's getting medicine. And the only length that you have in the problem is the interfunctional distance, which in a Fermi gas is fixed by the Fermi momentum. For this reason, because of strong interaction, you have a erotic superfluidity, and as I have shown before, we have a large critical superfluidity and a high critical temperature. So this system, which are the coldest system that have been realized in many modern physics, at the end are a very high temperature systems. High temperature in the sense of high TC phenomena. So the critical temperature compared to the Fermi temperature is very high, it's a fraction of 20%. While, as you can see, in conventional superconductors, the ratio between TC and the Fermi temperature is very small. In a superfluidium case, very small. Even high-T superconductors, which 20 years ago have been proposed as possible solution on different applications, are colder than our gases, the version of the fractions, where the critical temperature is about 20% of the so I would like to ask the organizer to tell me exactly what is the time.
Five minutes,
yes. Okay, so I will complete. What's important for Fermi gases in an important series of experiments carried out at MIT in the group of Martin Seligman, following the procedures introduced first at the Conormal in the group of Christoph Salomon, it has been possible to measure the thermodynamic behavior of this strongly interacting Fermi gases with a high accuracy. And I would like to outline the main idea. The main idea is that measuring the core density, or let's say the double integrated density with larger techniques, you can measure the pressure on the symmetry axis of the system. And you can measure this for a given value of the position parameter. So typically you have a gas like this, and integrating along this is Z, integrating over X and Y the signal, you know, different values of Z, you can obtain the pressure of the gas on the main axis as a function of Z. And in this experiment, it was possible to measure also the compressibility of the gas and to build with these sophisticated techniques the whole thermodynamic data. So what's interesting with these new methodologies introduced by the Conormal committee, it's possible to measure the thermodynamic data of uniform vector by taking density images in a monitor. This is really a remarkable possibility. And typical examples of this approach, for example, contained in this relationship, which shows the depression in proper units, lambda is the Brolyi parameter length, can be written in terms of dimensionless function, which depends only on the ratio between chemical potential and temperature. And then now you can measure these functions from the unit references, and you can start from this function. You have all the thermodynamic behavior accessible, and you can consequently measure all the thermodynamic functions, like entropy, specific heat, etc., etc. I would like to show these are the new results in the paper by Freeline and collaborators, where you can see that the specific heat exhibits a well-defined peak and the transition between the superfluid and the lower part, which permits to identify the critical temperature for this system in units of the film temperature, which you see that is given that this results with rather high precisions. I'm not saying that they don't understand how they got such a high precision, but they were clearly using the kinetics of the measurements. And what's even more interesting is that the shape of the specific heat is very similar to the one that was observed many years ago in the 20s by Cameron Jones in London. This is the lambda transition of the specific heat of supercritical. And you see how close on the shape of this one, which suggests that all this system belong to the same class of superfluid phenomena, and which can be described in proper ways using the normalization of DNA and more sophisticated joint approaches. The major question, and here we stop, is can we measure the superfluid density? Because all these measurements, which are essentially unable to measure this function, measure all the thermodynamic properties of our families. So you can measure specific heat, as I have shown, entropy, pressure, and energy, all these things can be measured, but not the superfluid density. Because the superfluid density cannot be written in terms of thermodynamic functions.
What is the number of atoms in that equation? Thermodynamics, density of atoms, or number of atoms?
The density of the vacuum is
just inside mu.
Now this is a relation between the pressure with the chemical potential.
So the number is inside chemical potential.
Yeah, but you have another relation of density that is given by another function which relates to the derivative of this quantity with respect to chemical potential. So, the clever idea of this relationship is to work with chemical potential.
Okay.
And density, like pressure, are output, not input of the approach.
Yes.
So I said that from the knowledge of this function, you can calculate all the thermodynamic functions, but not the superfluid density. In order to measure the superfluid density, it's not enough to measure the thermodynamic function. You need to measure some transport phenomena, some dynamic phenomena, and then the most elegant way to do this is to measure the propagation of second phenomena, which gives direct access to the behavior of the superfluid density. And this was done in a joint theoretical experimental work with the and I will discuss this tomorrow. I would like to say that in liquid helium, the best measure of superfluid density comes from the measurement of second sound. So second sound is actually the best way to measure the superfluid density. All the other methods, which are based on the measurement of critical velocity, for the moment of the national, are less responsive, even in Piedmont, and well, the high precision of the measurements of the density comes with the precision with which you can measure the circumstance. And this will be discussed tomorrow.
Okay.
So I know that you don't raise questions, but if you are ready to raise questions, I would be very, of course, happy to answer. But if we are discussing here with the other speakers, just then this meeting is.
No, just to look at my question. At unitarity for Fermi gases, you talked about superfluid density, I think, and normal density.
Yes.
No, you never talk about what we call the anomalous density.
I never talk about that?
The anomalous density.
Oh, anomalous density, okay. Yeah. So anomalous density is related to. You mean the expectation value at Degen? No, I never thought about this, because this quantity never enters the thermodynamic properties of the system. So of course, in some cases, in the case of bosons, you need the theories to handle with anomalous density,
yes.
As was done by Griffin and other people, and in order to solve the mini body problem, taking the point of view of Bose-Einstein condensation. But in the case of fermions, this procedure is less popular, I would say, for the normal density. But I don't know, maybe there are also approaches on Fermi gases using the normal densities. So the physical quantity that can be measured on condensate and the superfluid. Measuring the anomalous density is more challenging. I don't know whether you can formulate experiments to measure it. But maybe clever ideas can be developed.
What you are looking for.
Okay.
Okay. So see you tomorrow.
Je suis le seul à prendre le monde, je vais prendre le monde.